C.S. Lewis made this famous argument that there are three options for interpreting the life of Jesus: Lord, liar, or lunatic. And one of the problems that's often pointed out is, what if there are other options? For example, legend. How do we know that Jesus actually did claim to be God? Do we have good historical evidence for that? Bart Ehrman has argued, and this is an older view going back to people like Albert Schweitzer, for example, that Jesus saw himself as an apocalyptic preacher announcing the kingdom of God, maybe even the Messiah, but not as divine. And he thinks there's this development. So after Jesus dies, the disciples come to believe he's risen from the dead. They first think that he's exalted to some kind of angelic-like status. Then they come to think that he pre-existed, his birth, and eventually you get to his full deity. So Ehrman thinks this is why you only get explicit claims of deity in the Gospel of John, whereas the material in Matthew, Mark, and Luke that he thinks goes back to the historical Jesus doesn't have those claims. So I want to give a response to this, and there's two things I'm going to pass over. I have a book coming out that I'll share more about in a few months, and I'll put the video description, details about that book in the description of this video. But two things I'll pass over. One is the background context. So Ehrman thinks that the categories of divine and human were more fluid in the first century. And I think that Larry Hurtado has shown pretty convincingly that not for first century Jews. They understood the uniqueness of God and the simplicity of God, but I really can't get into that in this video. The other thing is, I'm going to assume the historical reconstruction that Ehrman impresses upon the New Testament. So I think that can be challenged. I think Richard Bauckham has made a good case that all four Gospels can be understood as eyewitness testimony. But let's just assume, let's go with only those passages that Ehrman and other higher critical scholars think go back to the historical Jesus. Now, in none of the four Gospels is Jesus's identity revealed, because he goes around saying, you know, God is a Trinity and I'm the second member of this Trinity. Jesus's identity is revealed in the context of his ministry, inaugurating God's kingdom, and the divine authority that he wields in that context. And the statements about his deity, even in John's gospel, come out in the context of the opposition he merits from the Pharisees and the other Jewish leadership. And in both John's gospel and in Mark's gospel, and in all Matthew and Luke as well, there's the concern of blasphemy among the Jewish leadership because Jesus is wielding this divine authority. For example, in Mark chapter 2, there's the famous story of the paralytic being lowered through the roof, and Jesus says, your sins are forgiven to this paralytic man. Now, Ehrman thinks that when Jesus says something like that, he never says, I forgive you. And the reason is, he's just trying to say, your sins are forgiven. In other words, he's just declaring, he's the messenger declaring that God has forgiven this person's sins. But in this story, the whole point of it is Jesus claiming his authority to forgive sins. So when he says this, the Jewish scribes who are present in verse 7 say, he's blaspheming, only God can forgive sins. And it says that Jesus senses this on their hearts, and he responds by healing the man. And the whole point of the healing is to show, I have the authority to heal, therefore I have the authority to forgive sins. And so that's what he says in verse 10, the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. Now this word authority there is so key. What happens throughout Mark's gospel is Jesus continues to wield a level of divine authority that merits the charge against him of blasphemy by the Jewish leadership. And there's so many examples of this we could talk about. He calls himself the Lord of the Sabbath. He equates devotion to the gospel with devotion to himself. And even the particular miracles and the way people respond to those miracles reveal something more than when you have Moses or Elijah doing miracles or something like that. You think when he walks on the water, the disciples are terrified and they say, who is this that even the wind and waves obey him? And in Matthew's gospel, in that account, they worship him after that. And all of this then climaxes at Jesus' trial in Mark chapter 14, where the high priest just asks him, "Are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed?" And Jesus responds, "I am, and you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of power and coming with the clouds of heaven." Now this is a reference to Daniel 7 and also perhaps to Psalm 110. And he's claiming not only to be the Messiah here, but to wield this divine authority for judgment. And that's why when the high priest hears that and the other Jewish leadership, they tear their clothes and accuse him of blasphemy for claiming that divine authority. So I think the contrast that Ehrman draws between John's gospel and this earlier material in Mark's gospel, for example, that Ehrman admits goes back to the historical Jesus is way too strong. I think all four gospels yield, with different emphases, nonetheless, a consistent portrait of someone who's way more than just a human preacher proclaiming the kingdom of God. He's claiming this authority to forgive, to judge. People are worshiping him in response. And that's all in Mark's gospel, which is in the 60s. Then you go back to Paul's letters in the 50s and some of the pre-Pauline traditions that Paul's quoting. Philippians 2, for example. Philippians chapter 2, verse 6 would be one example in Paul's writings where there's reference to Jesus in some way identified with God. He has a divine identity. Now, certainly there's development in how that is understood. But the thing that I find so striking is how early on the crucial moves take place in that identity. One scholar, Martin Hengel, puts it like this: more happened in this period of less than two decades, that's between Jesus' death and Paul's writings, than in the whole next seven centuries up to the time when the doctrine of the early church was completed. And there's another New Testament scholar who says, in the New Testament, the highest Christology is the earliest. And this is not the stuff of legend like Robin Hood or King Arthur or something like that, where you have all this development and you're not sure where it started. The development of the understanding of Jesus as worthy of worship and divine in some sense happens seemingly immediately or almost immediately by the time you get those earliest parts of the New Testament. That, of course, doesn't prove that Jesus was God in and of itself, but I think it does put Lewis's trilemma back on the table. We've got to make some sense of this figure who made these claims. I'd love to hear what you think in the comments, and I want to say thanks so much to those of you who've subscribed and are supporting these videos. I'll continue to be putting them out about once a week. So thanks for watching.